My name is Sumathipala, Wathugala. Since my name is very long, everybody use very short name. It's called Wathu. Wathu is not only here, wherever I work, people use Wathu as my short name, but also everybody think about Wathu is my first name also. Actually, it is Wathugala is my surname.
Okay.
And if I mention about me, of course, I'm a Sri Lankan, but also Australian. I started working with the UN since 1989 with a lot of peacekeeping operation with hardship in Israel, the Lebanon, Angola, and Brindisi in Italy. But I moved to ICTR 1997 because I want to move to family mission. Because I was not with my family longer period, only I was with my family in Israel. After that, they were in Australia. I was in a different mission, non-family. And then I moved here. Of course, I took that assignment here very happily. And of course, maybe I could say that when I arrived here, of course, I knew some staff members who were here before I worked with him. It is a bit courage for me. When I joined here, my position was Chief of Building Management Services. Actually, before me, there was nobody qualified building management, Chief of Building Management. I'm the first engineer who qualified to do the Chief of Building Management Services arrive here. That's it. There were no people to do the job, and they were double-hatting, and then likewise. But I'm the one first came as engineer to do the right qualification to do the job. And then, since I came, I had to review everything what's doing here to make an engineering way to do that. Of course, when I came here, already started the designing of second and third courtroom. It's given a consultant. It's called American consultant, Wakes consultant. They were doing. But now, since I come, actually, I was able to use him much better way because I could talk to him technical way. Before there were no much people to say changes or anything. Whatever he said, everybody has to believe him and do it. I could have changed something likewise.
Tell me about the early days of the ICTR. What was the situation that you worked into?
When I came here, we were only confined to the maybe one floor to maybe three floors. And not only that, all the staff are scattered. As staff arrived, regardless of the section he worked, they put the next room. That means, every section staffs are scattered. Okay, one of my exercises is to bring them together, to put them together, gradually. Likewise, I managed to bring them to the closer way and say for the efficiency of the work. And of course, as usual, there was electricity problems, water problems, and if we see these toilets, even today, we put a notice there, make sure you close the tap when you leave. Because sometimes they leave tap open, looking for water, and forget to close, and the night, midnight, the water arrives. And the whole floors are flooded. And we have to come in the night to come and find the way to close and arrange to clean and like that. And transportation was difficult. That's why ICTR was provided every staff transportation, morning, lunch, and the evening to go home and come back. And but even though it is helpful, but also it's a long way because the idea was to provide transportation to the home, not to the collection points. And if I get into a bus, if 15 people has to drop, that means it's going like a circle. Sometimes when you reach your home, it's already 2 hours gone. It's the same way, lunch hour. A lot of people going home, and really it's a long lunch because of the issue of dropping and picking them. In the evening, same issue. And the ICTR also didn't have enough vehicles and like that. Later on, ICTR decided to hire vehicles with the drivers. That's a way kind of gradually ICTR has managed to buy their own vehicles and slowly, I think, dropped the idea of providing transportation for lunch hour, only the evening, and the later on it changed it again to the only for national staff, not international staff. Likewise, as while improving the condition in the town, and it's also scaled down that assistance gradually.
Maybe you can talk a little bit about the relationship between Arusha and the ICTR, because like with your position, there's been a lot of back and forth.
Yes. As I said, I was chief of building management services when I joined. And, of course, I had to deal with national, you know, the like a municipality, the electrical authority, water authority, to talk to them and get some services. And but, you know, as it's very not easy to get that services the way I want, because they are not serious on, you know, to understand and act accordingly. Because always, you know, they say, how do you call, no hurry in Africa, they say like that. That's why it's always the way I want to get the job done. We have to go too many times to get something done. And also, sometimes they don't give the right answers. Reason is, you know, supposing there's a water rationing, some other reason, maybe their own failures, but they didn't give the right reason. Give another reasons, but anyway, we didn't have any choice, and especially for this place, when they don't have choice, we convince our landlord, okay, we cannot work like that. You better drill borehole here and get our own water supply system. Finally, you know, even same difficulty we had with them to convince to get a water borehole to be built, and it was built. Now, when there's no water in town supply, actually there has an alternate. Now, since then, we don't have a serious problem of water this compound. But now, I know that they are now happy that my proposal taken care and get the job done. But initially, you know, it's very difficult to convince. But this is the way. It's the same way everywhere, even in non-engineering people to talk about something and get done is very difficult to convince. But after a few weeks or a few months, they said, yeah, it's a good idea what you propose to me. It's like that. Even within ICTR, I can tell you, every year we expand by additional 1,000 square meters. That's the ratio we go every year since 97. Probably not every year exactly like that. There's a number of years until we come to the peak. The peak time, we had like 1,100 square meters office space. It means we every year we add like 1,000 square meters. You know, when you're adding, you have to understand there's a great difficulty of staff space planning. The reason is that 1,000 square meter, I had to move somebody there, right? Of course, if we move one section out of the other areas, probably the remaining area I had to bring another small section. And then every vacant space created by other place, we had to be reshuffled and to make sure they are together. Now, when you want to relocate somebody, it's very difficult. You know, it's a human nature. No one likes to relocate. You know, packing and disturbing the way you leave the room, they don't like. But I guarantee that everybody, when you leave, you know, after long struggle, to 1 month, if I go and ask, how is your place? Oh, is this better? That's what I heard, always. But that's, I agree that, because they cannot imagine the situation like me. They are just working, a lawyer or somebody. They don't realize how easy this place or how bad that place cannot be visualized in advance.
Right, now you're in New York, you're used to, you turn the tap, the water comes out, you turn on the light switch, the light comes on. It's things that you don't even think about.
Yeah, likewise, we managed to relocate. And you know that initially we are in Kilimanjaro and Mesa and Flow only. And gradually we managed to get complete Serengeti wing. All the floors were occupied by ICTR. And then, except two floors here, we occupied this Kilimanjaro wing.
What was this being used beforehand?
Who?
The
private tenants. Private tenants, actually, some of them are left their own way, but some of them are actually, maybe by force, by AICC, they asked them to leave. The reason is, you know, they want us. Because our money is guaranteed. Probably our rates are better rather than individually managing. And they were somehow, I don't know how they influenced them to leave. Probably they increased the rent for them. Or whatever way, they managed to get them out and give to us. Okay, I know one of the vendor tenant was staying here, NGO. He was really unhappy, you know, because of ICTR when he has to leave. Even I think he wrote something to the newspaper or somewhere. I remember one time, it's like that.
But you felt like there was a greater purpose that justified having to have him move out?
Yeah, but you see that I didn't really negotiate with him because it's not my duty to negotiate. It's the land, but indirectly they were, you know, blaming ICTR. Because he remodified the area the way he liked it, and then he had to leave. That means whatever his investment is cannibalized. I think that was the main reason. I cannot remember exactly. I don't know whether we contribute something to him, you know, to get, because we're going to use it his facility, whatever he left it.
What has your time here taught you, working at the ICTR?
The real thought is, you know, this is the first time I start working for a tribunal. You know, in my life, I never been to a courtroom. I never been to a prison. But after I came here to see that, now I got experience how to do a courtroom. I know what courtroom requirements are. I know how to build a prison today. Before I had the facility to know, when I joined UN, I worked for peacekeeping. Then I know what the military requirement. Military people, their observation point, bunkers, or all the observation towers, like that. Those requirements I managed to utilize for the prisons. Prison also to be supposed to be secured places. But the prisons, I never been to a prison, but with the client requirement, and also ICRC, I think they have a kind of conditions to meet the requirement, and we managed to build, we modify the prison and also expand the prison up to, I think, 110 cells, I believe. We made it in the UNDF. And also I built prisons in Mali, Benin, and now is almost completed the prison in Senegal.
Oh, wow.
Yes, that's also a part of my projects.
That's interesting.
Okay.
And to think about these buildings, I mean, there's certainly the aesthetic requirements, the technical requirements.
Yeah, I understand.
The logistics, like getting it all efficiently organized. In a visually appealing way.
Yeah.
But then these buildings are also loaded with meaning, too.
Yes.
What happens in these courts? What happens in these prisons? You've created these structures, and now they're being used by others, sometimes in ways that you intend, sometimes maybe in slightly different ways. How do you feel about this? I mean, has what happened in these halls and in these prisons something that you identify with and are proud of?
Okay. Let me talk about the first thing in the courtroom. You mentioned about how you do the job. You know that when you are doing this courtroom working, you know we are working on a lot of conditions need to be met when you're building a courtroom, which is, you know, who are the participants, you know, chambers, that is judges, court management, the registrars, people, language section, prosecutor, defense, public information, audiovisual. All their requirement has to be met when you design, as much as possible. And then, but unfortunately, this building has a defined width, defined length. And we had to try to find the way, the best way to suit that. And what we did is to dismantle all the internal partitions of without damaging original structure. You know, structural members we didn't touch. We only do internal partitions, which is no structural value. Okay? And also we managed to get approval from the landlord to do that. And also, actually, agreement is like we don't have to put it back either. That means that now you can understand, the, you are now in a courtroom. This one is a, was a courtroom. And then later on I convert to a library. Okay? And if the day we leave, we really do not have to do any changes. We can do as it is. Because whoever come to work for a tenant here, they may, everybody has a different requirement. They can reconfigure the area the way they like it. I know in Europe it's easy because they have a mobile partitions and like that to do it. Because I work with IAEA, to make a room different size is a 2 days job, but not like here. Okay, it's like that. And similarly, in the prisons, when you make those changes, you know, of course it's not like the current Tanzanian prison. Tanzanian prisons are dormitory type. They all sleep in one room, you know, sometimes it's really crowded. But the way we built in internal room and with the attached toilet, we thought that, you know, at the end, even though we build this facility, it's not really going to be a waste. You know, Tanzanian prison officials also, you know, the guards, they also need rooms. At the moment, they also sleep on tents, what we provided. In the long run, they can keep that facilities as their staff accommodation. Actually, it's not a really waste to the country. And also, oh, another way, they can put it political prisoners, if they have. They need to treat differently. That's another way. Also, I realize when you are doing our work here, you know, getting qualified contractors to do job is difficult. But as I said, no one is serious on to do to job in as agreed time. There, you know, you have to push so much. Even you know, staff who hired also is the same issue. You know, no matter what I asked to do, no one is come back to me within the deadline, whether it's completed or not able to complete. You need to constantly follow up unless the job going through. Okay? We have to ask every time. Every day. I expect that job to be completed in 2 days. 2 days time, I may not get the answer.
Right.
I have to ask the answer saying, did you complete or not complete?
There's all the technical difficulties of building a prison or a courtroom here. But how philosophically... For you,
what?
How does it feel, just on a personal level, to create a courtroom or a prison? These are very loaded.
Oh, okay.
These are very loaded places.
I understand. Yeah, yeah. But I know that, as I said, personally, I don't like to be go to a prison. Any reason, I don't like to go to a courtroom either. But as for the objective of ICTR, I'm not be unhappy about that because I was involved. In a courtroom, it's a better way, you know, the betterment for the world. Okay? It's like the peace or reconciliation or that kind of arrangement is a part of the exercise, even those prisons. But also I build the prisons not to be harm their humanity. You know, if I go to the local prison, how they kept them, I don't like it. I didn't involve on those kind of a construction. But the way I build prisons, the prisoners have their normal rights. Only that I can see that what they are missing is to, you know, the not to be able to beat their loved ones. But they are comfortably have all the facilities. That means I'm not regretting, you know, building prisons for any reason, because I build the maximum, you know, the facilities for them to have a good facilities, them to have it. It's not because of my requirement. It was, you know, the in the management wise, that was a requirement. And then we build that facilities and also ICRC conditions. That means we didn't put them in a bad shape, and I was not part of that.
Right. Well, it's so interesting to be having this conversation too, because it speaks to much larger issues. Of, for example, I spoke with someone when I first arrived who had just visited the detention facility here, and I said, how was it? And they're like, this is the nicest prisons I've ever seen. Like, they're living so well.
Yes.
And it was complicated for him, because, like, built into this idea of a prison or a detention facility is punishment. Mm. And they were almost shocked by how humane
way to do things
the detention facility
yes
is. Where is that line when you're creating this?
Yeah, as I said, you know, since I never had experience on how the prison facility is supposed to be, you know, whatever I'm going to do, I did it here, it is the first experience. It is means, you know, if management says that they need to have a library, or they need to have a computer room, they need to have a gym, you know, I realize, you know, it is a requirement for any human. It just, but only thing is, what I learned from here, for the international standard, they are confined to an area. That's the only punishment, nothing else.
So the rest should be as comfortable.
And yeah, as comfortable the way. But I know a lot of people, when you hear that one, they get, oh, you know, you given a five-star hotel for them to live. But I think international standard way, the only point is they are confined to a particular area. And not only that, I know that some prisons, we even built conjugal facilities, you know, and also even the safe houses. The family, the partners can visit them, even in the prison here.
Mm-hmm. Are the safe houses, is that also under your...
Yes, yes. Safe houses, actually, my responsibility was to rent and provide all the services. You know, maintenance, water, electricity, generator power, like that.
How much maintenance is that?
Not that maintenance, because, you know, it's a rented houses. Landlord has some responsibilities. So only minor responsibilities on the maintenance-wise, because if we damage something, I had to repair. But periodically, you know, wear and tear is a landlord responsibility.
Okay.
But the prison is ours. Everything I had to do, you know, the periodically painting and all other facilities. And the prison area also, maybe I forgot in the beginning, it was not, we finally purchased some half-done buildings from them, government. We pay for them. And then we build some prison facilities over their foundation. And then we had to pay for them to government to pay, take some areas to develop themselves. And we had that kind of way. And also I want to tell you that the beginning, as I said, since I was not aware about courtroom, but before I arrived, there was a consultant working for the courtroom. But the contractors were also, I know, less people. Finally, when you come to the fourth courtroom building, you know, we didn't hire any consultant. I did myself design. And we didn't get a very complicated contractors, pre-qualification of vendors, contractors, and like that. We managed to get a contractor who already bit experienced person. And not only that, I can tell you, I think first two courtroom to build, we spend around 9 months, 6 to 9 months. And spend around nearly $500,000, I think. Consultancy fees and a lot of areas. But we managed to build the fourth courtroom within a month. And I remember it's $150,000. That's the way. I think if we are in the morning or yesterday, Judge Moses is talking about fourth courtroom. It was, he was behind Okay, he's eager to get the courtroom in 1 month. And also we were, every day he also come into the courtroom to see how the things are going, where the difficulties are, and likewise. Mm-hmm. And it was day and night, three shift or two shift, I think it's worked, and we managed to complete in 1 month. Similarly, you know, this the yesterday what we opened, mm-hmm. we spent only 3 weeks to complete. Okay, that's the way. Most difficult part is to, during the construction-wise, the qualified contractors, they don't know new technological way to do things. If you want to introduce this material to bring from overseas, is difficult. Getting a tax exemption is difficult. Okay, and delays coming here, because we are away from the port, the heavy material to come through the year, it takes time. Likewise. Also, you know that since the nature of ICTR is semi-permanent, you know, today we are talking about closure. But in the past, we don't know when to close. And then when you are doing a particular building, we don't know whether how much time to be last long this whatever I'm doing. Sometimes I can say to somebody, you do something I need only for one year to survive. Or something like that, right. In a mind that, because after that it can be dismantled. But now, you know, the coming last 2-3 years, I can say like that. But before, we don't know how many years to be last long. Whatever I'm doing,
right,
it is a question for that. And you know, do things in very permanent way, or the more temporary way. It's like that. There's a dilemma to decide. Anyway, whatever I make a decision, you know. I was able to convince the management to do whatever is the best way to go forward the these ICTR requirements. Yes.
Great. Thank you so much.
Okay.